Welcome, everybody, to the Center for Strategic and International Studies. My name is Sarah Ladislaw, and I direct the Energy and National Security Program here. Before I get the program started, please allow me to remind you that we take security very seriously here. We don't expect any kind of incident or accident, but in the event of such an event, I am sort of your security captain. Today to have such a large and esteemed audience for the presentation of OPEC's World Oil Outlook. As many of you know, the CSIS Energy National Security Program hosts most of the world's publicly and privately developed energy outlooks. And we do this to be able to foster an open exchange of views on the changing energy landscape. We're very pleased to be hosting for the first time OPEC's World Oil Outlook, which is in its 10th year of production. Quite frankly, it couldn't come at a better time with oil markets entering a precarious year of rebalancing and OPEC recently concluding two meetings and signaling its intent to support a production cut from both OPEC and non-OPEC members in support of that rebalancing. There's certainly a lot to talk about today. Our program this morning will have two parts. The first is a presentation about the outlook, and the second is a moderated discussion between His Excellency Mohammad Barkindo, Secretary General of OPEC, and John Hess, who is the CEO of Hess Corporation and a CSIS trustee. It's a great pleasure to introduce to you all Mohammad Barkindo, the Secretary General of the Organization of Petroleum and Exporting Countries. Secretary General Barkindo has a long history of working in key roles at OPEC, including as Acting Secretary General in the oil and gas industry in Nigeria, as Group Managing Director at NNPC. And he's also been an active shaper of global climate change negotiations through the UNFCCC and has served on the UN Commission on Sustainable Development. He's accompanied by Dr. Jorge Leon Arellano, who is the energy demand specialist of the OPEC Research Division, is laughing at me at how I just butchered his name, who is going to present the World Oil Outlook. So Mr. Secretary General, you'll introduce the outlook, please. Welcome to CSIS. It's a pleasure to have you. Thank you very much. Press the button because your mic's on.
Good morning, distinguished colleagues and friends from the industry, from the academia. I was just talking with my partner, John Hayes, that there is no better place to be at this time after all what we went through from the summer till just a couple of days ago than to CSIS. I'm so glad to be here with my colleagues from the OPEC Secretariat. Allow me to begin by thanking Thomas Pritzker, the CSIS chairman, John Hammer, CSIS president and CEO, as well as my partner John Hess, who is also a member of the board of trustees, not to talk of an old friend, Sarah, for facilitating this visit. As Sarah mentioned, after my opening remarks, I intend to invite my colleague Jorge Leon from our Energy Studies Department to take us through some of the key findings from our 10th World Oil Outlook, which was just released last month at the Abu Dhabi International Petroleum and Exhibition Conference. ADIPEC. Let me say that we are really honored, Sarah, to be here, and thank you for fulfilling your pledge when we last met. I think before Algiers and before the Vienna meetings, and you did promise that you will give us this opportunity to come and share, compare notes with colleagues here. Before coming here, I had a look at your event schedule of the last month, and was pleased to see that you recently hosted two very prominent members of the OPEC family. So it made me feel much more at home here. Ali Al-Naimi, the former Minister of Petroleum and Mineral Resources of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, was here in April of this year to share his views on the dynamic changes in the global energy markets. He undoubtedly also spoke about his compelling life story and his illustrious career at the top echelon of the oil industry, both within his country and globally. Although he has now retired, but he is not tired, as you have seen him, still very active, still walking every morning, taking some jogs. He is still remembered and appreciated at OPEC for his countless contributions, steadfastly guiding his country and our organization through several very challenging energy cycles. He has tirelessly devoted his efforts to promoting stability and growth in the international oil and gas industry. I first met Ali Naimi in 1985 when he was CEO of Saudi Aramco, and had followed, had worked with him closely in the 21 years that he had served as the Minister of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. I also was very glad to notice that his very able successor, Khalid Al-Fali, was also here recently, as recently as June, to discuss the Saudi-US relationship as well as the Vision 2030 of the Kingdom. Khalid Al-Fali is a very able successor, although in Ali Naimi's shoes, despite his size, he wears a very large size of shoes. But we are very pleased at OPEC with the coming on board of Khalid Al-Fali. And if I may digress, in 2008, when we first met at a retreat in Pennyhill outside London, he came to represent Ali Juma, Abdullah Juma, his previous boss, CEO of Aramco, who was not able to make it, and he decided to send Khalid Al-Fali, who was the vice president, to represent him. And in sending him, he also sent a note to the organizers of the retreat to apologize that although he was not able to attend, but he was sending somebody he could describe as the best Aramco had ever produced to represent him. This was in 2008, and Abdullah Juma was very prophetic. Khalid Al-Fali fully represents that picture. So we're very glad to have him. Our presentation here today at CSIS is part of a week-long US visit, which you encouraged us to do last time I came, Sarah. Yesterday we had a very engaging discussions with one of the leading icons of the industry, Daniel Yergin, and his colleagues at IHS, as well as at the International Monetary Fund, to where we discussed at length our world oil outlook. It is a distinct honor to be here, and we intend to meet. I've met also for the first time a partner here, Adam Simisky, for the EIA, and we look forward to meeting with him and his team in order to continue this dialogue that Sarah, you encourage us to embark upon. We're really grateful for that support. During the week, we will be also meeting with a select leading hedge funds in Wall Street in New York. Those market makers who just coming out of my hotel, checking with colleagues, what's the total volume of paper barrels being traded both in New York and London. I was astonished. For the month of November, I was told by my able colleagues that in total, if you put both New York and London, you're talking of about 48 million contracts, totaling about 48 billion paper barrels being traded. Now, and for us, marginal players who in the physical market, maybe about 94, 95 million, including Jones production, tight oil, very important. I think it's important for us, we thought that we should exploit coming here to meet with this very important segment of the industry to even comprehend how do they operate. Our presentations here today is therefore going to focus, as I said earlier, on our outlook. We estimate that the United States imports about 3.6 million barrels a day of liquids from OPEC member countries. And this is out of a total U.S. consumption of about 20 million barrels a day. This makes the U.S. a vital customer to all our member countries, a very important global leader in this industry. Therefore, you can understand why our first port of call after our meetings in Vienna is to come to this great country. Thus, it is my hope that our meetings and consultations here this week will open up a new cycle of ongoing dialogue between our organization and the United States. Both parties have nothing to lose and everything to gain with this type of cooperation and dialogue. Over the previous years, I have had the opportunity to spend quite a lot of time here in Washington, mainly pursuing my academic goals in higher education at George Mason with my professor, John Payden, who promised that he will honor Sarah's invitation. I hope he will join us shortly. Today, though, I return here for a different reason and in a different capacity. This time, I come as a representative of OPEC, this organization that we hate to love sometimes, which has recently gone through a very severe cycle, oil cycle. In the last few years, there has been talk that perhaps this organization was no longer relevant and that it had possibly lost the key role it has played in the world of energy since its founding in Baghdad in September of 1960. Well, colleagues, I'm here to report that we are still alive and well, and we hope together we can move forward to continue to play a very constructive and stabilizing role in this industry of ours. Any naysayers that may have had doubt about OPEC's efficacy were proven wrong with the historic decision that was made by us recently on the 30th of November and subsequent meetings. I'm referring to what we now call the Vienna Agreement, which was the OPEC's conference decision to implement a new production target of 32.5 million barrels a day. This is a reduction of around 1.2 million barrels a day. The goal of this agreement is to accelerate the ongoing drawdown of the stock overhang, and it's to expedite the rebalancing of this market that has been out of balance for quite too long. This is the first production adjustment that OPEC has made since 2008 at the outset of the global financial crisis in Oran, in Algeria. It is also the first time since 1998 that Iraq is back as part of our production management process. It has been exempted by OPEC from this role due to the geopolitical challenges that Iraq had faced over the past several years or decades. And finally, this agreement marks the first time that our non-OPEC friends and colleagues have joined OPEC in a concerted effort to help bring stability back to this very fragile and battered market in this severe cycle, probably the longest and the worst that we have seen in the last five or six cycles John Hess reminded me when we met in London at the Oil and Money Conference. If you recall, with those encouraging words that we must move and work together to restore stability, that the industry needs stability on a sustainable basis, and no one group of countries or institutions can do this alone. Hence the very importance of this gathering. And finally, the achievement of this important agreement is the culmination of months of intensive consultations held among OPEC member countries and also between OPEC and non-OPEC member countries. I personally have traveled and visited several of our capitals, both OPEC and non-OPEC, in order to help build support, to build the consensus that was urgently required, not only within our organization, but between us and the non-OPEC, taking into account the geopolitical challenges taking place in some of our producing regions. The many miles of travel and countless hours spent in meeting rooms all, I believe, paid off when we reached our initial accord in Algiers, which was adopted at the 170th meeting of the conference held in this city on the 28th of September. This then became known as the Algiers Accord, which we now know has been approved for implementation as part of the Vienna Agreement that was agreed upon on the 30th of November in Vienna. So why, you may ask, is this also relevant? Well, to answer that, let me take us back to 2014 when this current down cycle began. Although Ali Naimi must have shared his views on what transpired in 2014 at the outset of this cycle, I would like to also, for the records, say that in the midst of an oversupplied market, we saw oil prices plummet, dropping to a low of $20 a barrel for some crudes early in 2016. This constitutes, distinguished colleagues, an enormous decline of prices of about 80% within a very short period of time. I'm not sure whether Ali Naimi and his colleagues in OPEC, as well as my colleagues at the Secretariat, anticipated this grave situation taking place for this long period of time. I think the expectation then from the mainstream of the industry that this correction, market correction, will just take a short period of time to correct the market, to rebalance the market. But how we all got it wrong. The chilling effect of this price crash was felt throughout the oil and gas industry. Thousands upon thousands of jobs were lost, unfortunately. Budgets were slashed, projects were deferred or canceled, investments were frozen or discontinued, and some producers went into bankruptcy. And this is all across the industry, both conventional as well as non-conventional. Global spending on exploration and production dropped by a whopping 26% in 2015, and is expected to decrease by an additional 22% this year. Altogether, this amounts to more than $300 billion US dollars in lost investment to this industry. Yesterday, in our round table with IHS, with Daniel Yergin and his able colleagues, some of the focus reporting very high numbers, especially between 2015 to 2020. Recently at Petrotech in New Delhi, we had figures between ranging between $1 trillion to $2 trillion within this period. This trend is not on track to continue into a third year, which will be unprecedented in the history of the oil industry. We have never had this sharp contraction in investment for three consecutive years, in our history. This is a frightening situation when you consider that a massive, according to our world oil outlook, a massive $10 trillion in oil-related investments is estimated to be required in the period to 2040 in order to meet future world energy demand. In today's oil market, the industry will simply not be able to meet this level of investment. These factors were the reasons the OPEC ministers decided it was time to take action and that the risks for not acting were dire for the industry. And here let me say also for the first time we have seen a convergence of views not only within OPEC but between OPEC and non-OPEC and also for the first time we have seen this convergence between producers and consumers. After the historic agreement on Wednesday, the 30th of November, the first visitor I received in Vienna, Sarah, was the Minister of Meiji of Japan to congratulate us for what we have done, that it was good not only for OPEC, not only for non-OPEC, not only for the oil industry, but he said is for producers as well as consumers and the global economy. And we repeatedly had this when I went to New Delhi last week at Petrotech from the Prime Minister. Let me emphasize that OPEC member countries remain absolutely committed to ensuring the long-term supply to the market. Our member countries continue to invest in both the upstream and downstream sectors despite the spike in cost and the shortage of adequately skilled labor. And this is also despite the sharp reduction in their national revenues and competing demand for socio-economic development. All our member countries are developing countries with huge demands from rising populations on the national treasury. Yet when I went around most of these member countries, they are still continuing to invest in the upstream in order to not only maintain current capacity, but to develop capacity to meet this future demand. According to our recently published outlook, global demand is forecast to rise by nearly 17 million barrels a day by the year 2040, at which time it will reach around 110 million barrels a day. So, colleagues, you can see that the world's oil producers, including OPEC, have their work cut out for them if they intend to meet the world's future energy requirements. But to achieve this, we all need a fair oil price and a stable market, which will provide fertile ground for the necessary investment in production, research, as well as development. One thing is for sure, though OPEC cannot achieve this alone, only through collaborative efforts and other open dialogue with fellow stakeholders will we meet with success. OPEC already has an extensive list of bilateral and multilateral meetings it holds annually with international stakeholders, including the European Union, the Russian Federation, China, India, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, the G20, the International Energy Agency, and the International Energy Forum. We hope now that the United States may join us for a new era of collaboration and dialogue so that we can work together toward our mutually beneficial goal of ensuring stability in the world energy markets. These conditions will contribute to economic growth and prosperity, two things we all desire for these and future generations. So what we have done in Algiers, in Vienna, between ourselves and 11 member countries of non-OPEC last week was not only for producers, it was also good for the global oil industry as well as the global economy. So I thank you very much for your kind attention. And Sarah, with your permission, may I invite my colleague, Jorge, to take us through our oil outlook. And they say talk of the devil. And just as we were talking about Professor John Payton and George Mason, I just saw him walking in there. Welcome, Prof. Thank you.
Excellent. Well done, my friend.
Press down.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Good morning, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here presenting to you the 2016th edition of the World Oil Outlook. This is the 10th edition, as His Excellency mentioned, and it's a great achievement for the organization. I'm one of the main authors of the report, together with a bunch of great experts back in Vienna. So welcome again. In case you're active in the social network, I invite you to tweet using the hashtag WU2016. So let me start by saying that the World Oil Outlook provides a very granular analysis on many aspects, many issues that are affecting our industry. However, in this presentation, I want to focus on four main questions where the outlook sheds a bit of light. The first one is the socio-economic outlook, how it will evolve up to 2040. Then we focus on the energy outlook, and we explore how we would evolve in the long term. We also provide very granular analysis in terms of the oil market outlook up to 2040. And finally, a new piece of analysis in this year's outlook, how could future energy policy changes affect the energy outlook? After the Paris Agreement, there's still a lot of uncertainty on how policies, energy policies, will evolve in the future, what would be the implementation path of those policies. So the outlook provides detail on how this could affect the energy outlook. So let me start with the socioeconomic outlook up to 2040. Of course, the socioeconomic outlook has a clear implications on the energy demand and finally on the oil demand evolution. So four main important socio-demographic changes in the world when we look into the long term. The first one is that the world population will grow. Currently, we are 7.3 billion people, and up to 2040, we will be 9.1 billion people. That's an addition of 1.8 billion people. And what I think is more important is that most of that growth will be coming. Of the forecast period, this number declines to 600 million people. So important change looking into the future here. The third important social demographic change is that overall the age structure of the population is aging. This is a good example here. The population age 65 or more currently accounts for 8% of the world. In 2040, this will account for 14% of the world population. And also the working age population will shrink slightly. And final important social demographic change is that the world is coming to town. The urbanization process continues. Currently, 54% of the people are living in urban areas. Into the future, 2040, we expect that this number will increase to 63%. The cities are getting larger, and the number of mega cities, which are the cities with more than 10 million people, will increase from 29 to more than 40 mega cities in the world, particularly in Asia. And this poses, of course, important questions for policymakers in these cities. But there will also be important changes from the economic point of view, and the key takeaway here is that the global economic picture will reshuffle. The world GDP more than doubles between 2015 and 2040. And what is even more important is that where this growth is coming from. And in fact, three quarters of the additional GDP between 2015 and 2040 will come from the developing countries. And here we cannot overemphasize the importance of China and India in this new economic picture. Together, they currently account for 24% of the world GDP, And in 2040, their share combined will be 40%. So 40% of the world GDP in 2040 will be China and India. And also, we want to emphasize the fact that average income levels in the world will increase. This will allow millions of people to exit poverty and join the middle class. But the income gap remains quite important. If we see average income levels in the richest regions versus the poorest regions, this gap remains quite wide. Now let's zoom in a little bit on the energy outlook up to 2040. And the key takeaway here, as His Excellency mentioned, is that the energy demand will increase by 40% between 2014 and 2040. You can see in the table that in 2014, total primary energy demand was 274 million barrels of oil equivalent per day. In 2040, we expect that that number will be 382 million barrels of oil equivalent per day. That's an average growth of 1.3% per annum. And most of this growth, surprise, surprise, will be coming from the developing countries, with an average growth of 2.1% per annum. And in the second graph, you can see that the average growth for some specific regions is quite important. You can see India, the average growth of energy demand is over 3.5% per annum. In terms of energy demand for the OECD region, we expect quite low growth, actually energy demand peaking around 2030 and then slightly declining on the back of further tightening of energy policies, of course. That's from the regional point of view. From the fuels point of view, the message is quite clear. The shift from fossil fuels to renewables is expected to continue. However, fossil fuels will continue to dominate the energy mix, accounting for 77% of the mix. However, the fast growth of other renewables, that's what includes mainly wind and solar, will start to kick in significantly. In particular for oil, it will remain as the most important fuel until the late 30s, when it's overtaken by gas. And if we focus in this graph on the growth in energy demand by fuel types, we see that most of the additional demand, energy demand, is going to be satisfied by gas. But also oil and other renewables will play quite an important role satisfying the world energy needs. And together, oil and gas are estimated to satisfy 53% of the world energy needs in the future. Another mega trend that we emphasize in the outlook is that the world is increasingly becoming more energy efficient and less energy poor. So you can see in this graph we have energy intensity, clear downward trend, and this is on the back of policies, tightening of energy efficiency policies, but also technological development and the changing composition of GDP as countries develop their service sector increases. And also energy poverty, as you can see there, the gap in the energy use per capita narrows between regions. However, the gap remains quite wide. The average energy use per capita in the developing world is still only one-third of what it's in the developed world by 2040. Now let me zoom in a little bit more on the oil market evolution up to 2040. And we start with the first side of the market, the demand side. As His Excellency mentioned, oil demand is set to increase to reach 109.4 million barrels per day in 2040. That's an increase of 16.4 million barrels per day during this period. But regionally, there are very important differences. While demand in the OECD is expected to drop, a drop of 9 million barrels per day, the demand in developing countries is expected to increase significantly, additional 25 million barrels per day. Another important observation here is that the growth of oil demand is expected to decelerate in the long term. This is quite important. Well, during the first 5 years of the forecast period, the average oil demand growth is 1.1 million barrels per day every year. Towards the end of the forecast period, it's only 0.3 million barrels per day every year. This is on the back of lower economic growth, lower population growth, but also tightening of energy efficiency policies. In terms of sectors, most of the growth will continue to come from the road transportation sector. Actually, one-third of the additional demand will come from the road transportation sector, but we also see a strong growth in the petrochemicals and in the aviation sector. I also wanted to zoom in a little bit more on the car fleet, on the road transportation. Every day we hear news and high expectations about the penetration of electric vehicles, for example. So the outlook provides quite a detailed analysis on how the car fleet will evolve into the future. So let me start by saying that the number of passenger cars will more than double when we look into the future. Currently, we have around 1.1 billion passenger cars in the world. And in the future, that number will reach 2.1 billion. So significant increase in the car fleet. But regionally, there are very important differences. The demand, the number of cars in the OECD will increase only marginally, as you can see in the graph, while most of the growth will come from the developing countries as income levels increase in those countries. But it's also important not where these cars are going to be located, but also what type of cars will be hitting the road in the future. And in the WU, we differentiate between conventional cars, which are pure gasoline, diesel, and LPG cars, versus non-conventionals, which include natural gas vehicles, hybrid vehicles, plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, battery electric vehicles, and fuel cell vehicles. And as you can see in the graph, the penetration of the non-conventionals is expected to increase quite significantly. Currently, they account for 4% of the car fleet, and in 2040, we expect that they will account for 22% of the car fleet, so quite an important increase. And we zoom in the non-conventionals, battery electric vehicles will be taking a leading role in the penetration. We expect 141 million battery electric vehicles in 2040. Now we move to the supply side of the market, and in the non-OPEC supply, we expect in the medium term that non-OPEC supply will recover slowly. Growth will come from Latin America, and particularly Brazil, but also U.S. and Canada, of course, putting some additional barrels in the medium term. The story is a little bit different in the long term, where non-OPEC supply is expected to, after the recovery, to remain fairly flat, to then decline post-2030. And what is also interesting to observe is that tight crude is the main source of growth initially, up to around 2025, 2030, and then oil sands and biofuels are starting to kick in as the main source of growth. And with this in mind, the demand for OPEC crude is expected to increase to 41 million barrels per day. That accounts for 37% of the world liquid supply. Currently, OPEC crude accounts for 33% of the world liquid supply. So, in a sense, the importance of OPEC crude to the market is expected to increase in the future. I also wanted to zoom in a little bit more on the tight crude prospects. And here we're showing North American tight crude outlook. We expect that it will recover in the medium term and will reach 6.3 million barrels per day in 2030, to then decline to 5.4 million barrels per day. But it is also just part of the one side of the story. There's also some additional barrels from outside North America, particularly in Argentina and Russia, where we expect towards the long term, so that the total tight crude outlook will reach 6.7 million barrels per day in 2030, and then expects to decline to around 6 million barrels per day in 2040. And if we add this to the unconventional NGLs, total tight oil, what we call total tight oil, which is the sum of tight crude plus and conventional NGLs, is expected to reach a high of 10 million barrels per day in 2029 and then decline to almost 9 million barrels per day in 2040. A few words also on the downstream analysis. The new distillation capacity is moving where demand is growing, that is basically other Asia Pacific, China, and Middle East. But the additional required capacity is expected to drop in the future. While in the first 5 years, 6 years of the forecast period, we will be adding around 1.4 million barrels per day of distillation capacity. In the long term, this number drops as a result of oil demand growth decelerating, but also the increasing non-crude supplies. And a few words on trade, oil trade, the growing crude imports from into Asia Pacific, growing from around 20 million barrels per day to close to 30 million barrels per day, and Middle East playing a key role as the main supply for the Asia Pacific region. And this brings me to the last point. This is the, as I mentioned, the new piece of analysis in the WU. We analyze how could future energy policy changes affect the energy outlook. After the Paris Agreement, still a lot of uncertainty on how energy policies will evolve and how that evolution will affect the energy outlook. So the outlook provides a scenario analysis based on these uncertainties to tackle this uncertainty. We have developed two scenarios. Scenario A, where we assume a slightly faster tightening of energy efficiency policies and emission reduction policies than in the reference case. And in scenario B, we're assuming an extreme scenario where there's a timely implementation of both conditional and unconditional INDCs. And the results are quite interesting. In both cases, the global energy demand declines, but also there's a shift within the energy mix. The demand for fossil fuels is reduced, and in particular, coal is very much affected as energy emission reduction policies are tackling the power generation sector. And there's also an increase in renewables and the nuclear energy. And in terms, there's also an impact, of course, on emissions. The total energy-related CO2 emissions could be 14% lower compared to the reference case in this extreme scenario B, where we assume a timely implementation of the INDCs. So let me just briefly summarize the key takeaways from this year's outlook. Energy demand is expected to increase by 40%. It will reach 382 million barrels of oil equivalent per day. And the energy mix is continue to be shifting away from fossil fuels to renewables. Oil demand, we expect growth, reaching 109.4 million barrels per day, but growth is expected to decelerate in the long term. Non-OPEC supply is expected to recover in the medium term, then remain fairly flat to then decline post-2030, so that the demand for OPEC crude is expected to increase to reach 41 million barrels per day at the end of the forecast period. On the downstream, we emphasize that the majority of the refining capacity is moving where demand is growing. That's basically Asia-Pacific and Middle East. And finally, the changes in energy policies could reduce energy demand and could further shift the energy mix towards renewables. And with this, I finish my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good job. Very crisp.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay. John.
Okay.
Go. Thanks.
Go ahead. You go first.
You can sit right in the middle. Okay. You have to switch it on. Let me do it. You sit in the middle.
Where do I sit?
In the middle. And you can sit on the far side. Okay.
Far side, sure.
Thank you. Okay, well, thank you very much, Dr. Leon, for that wonderful presentation. I think you get a record for a really good and quick delivery of a very insightful outlook. We do have copies for any of those of you who have not read the World Oil Outlook. There is a lot of information in there on a number of topics that we've been talking about over the last several weeks. But we'll take some questions after we have a little bit of a discussion, both on the outlook and the wonderful work that you all have done. But we wanted to take this opportunity because of the proximity to the OPEC agreements and all of the sort of dynamism we're experiencing in the oil markets to have a little bit of a conversation about that. Secretary Barkindo, last time you were here, right after Alger's, you said to me that this was vintage OPEC. And I said, well, what happened? And you said, well, this is vintage OPEC, and you've done a pretty good job sort of delivering on that. But you were also fairly clear-eyed about the challenge of getting from Alger's to where you and OPEC members have achieved the agreement in Vienna and the one over the weekend. Can you characterize for us what you see as the main challenges going forward now that you've reached that agreement?
Thank you very much, Sarah. I vividly recall coming out of Algiers end of September. I headed to Washington, and I was here with your good self and your colleagues to brainstorm on the outcome of the Algiers Accord and the way forward to Vienna, November 30th. And I must say that our brainstorming and consultations we had here at CSIS were very constructive, very instructive and helpful for me personally and my colleagues to navigate through from Algiers to Vienna on November 30. Now, as you rightly said, the issue now is how do we move forward from here? We had agreed together with our non-OPEC partners, 11 member countries of the non-OPEC group led by the Russian Federation on the 10th, on Saturday, just this last Saturday, to jointly readjust our supplies to the market to the tune of nearly 1.8 million barrels a day with effect from 1st of January. And we also jointly agreed with them that this agreement initially would be for a period of 6 months, beginning January 2017. And thirdly, very significant and also historic was that both groups agreed to establish a joint ministerial monitoring committee comprising of three OPEC member countries, Kuwait, Algeria, and Venezuela, and on the non-OPEC side, the Russian Federation and the Sultanate of Oman. This committee will work with the OPEC Secretariat in order to monitor compliance, and this is the first time this has happened between us and non-OPEC. So the level of commitment that I have seen in Vienna, both on November 30th and on December 10th, I think was unprecedented. There was commitment at the highest levels of our governments. Almost all our sovereigns were involved, mostly behind the scenes, to ensure that we delivered as OPEC, and also between OPEC and non-OPEC, with the sole objective of restoring balance to this fragile market that has been out of balance since the summer or the fall of 2014, with severe consequences on the industry, on the treasuries of our member countries, including the non-OPEC, and also probably for the first time, with a significant impact on the economies of the major consuming countries. I just told you that immediately after our conference in Vienna, I had an August visitor, the Minister of Meiji from Japan, who came not only to congratulate us for what we did, but to endorse the decision that it was good for Japan, struggling to come out of deflation, and several other OECD countries in that economic condition, with the banks sometimes interest rates at very low levels, historic levels, and sometimes even in negative territory. So I am confident that what we did was to turn a historic page in global oil. And by establishing this platform of OPEC and non-OPEC, I am confident that we are on course of a new global alliance among producers, supported by consumers, that will ensure some level of stability in the oil markets in the short, medium, and long term, that will ensure sustained investments in all the entire supply chain, but particularly in the E&P. I know my partner, John, would share his experience with us. For us as OPEC, we remain committed to continuing to be a dependable and reliable supplier of oil to our consumers. And therefore, it's crucial for us to do everything we can policy-wise to ensure that the industry attracts the investments that we require in order to ensure the security of future supply, which is in the best interest of the global economy.
Great. Well, and John, what about that perspective from industry? I mean, clearly low oil prices over a period of 2 years. Secretary General Barkindo has spoken about some of the drivers for the decisions that they've made. What's your perspective on the impact that it's had on industry and your outlook going forward? Sure. And,
you know, this deal, this agreement that His Excellency, the Secretary General, and 13 members of OPEC and 11 other countries from non-OPEC making this agreement. It's historic, it's monumental, really, to have this many countries with different interests come together for a common cause. And it's absolutely essential for future price stability, future price security, as well as global security for energy supply. So I think we need to congratulate His Excellency, the Secretary General, and his member countries for having the courage to push this through because it really is essential for future energy supplies in the world, as you could see from the 2040 outlook that the Secretary General's colleague just presented. You know, to have Russia in it, to have non-OPEC members in it, along with OPEC members, I think it bodes well for the future. I also think it needs to be noted that having the Secretary General here in the U.S., with the U.S. being the largest oil and gas producer as well as the largest oil consumer, to be extending goodwill and build understanding both from the OPEC side but now the U.S. side bodes well for the future of price security as well as price stability. So it's very heartening. You know, you say, you know, why is this agreement so important? We had a glut. It was a stubborn glut from overproduction. And even though demand was increasing every year for oil, 1 million barrels a day, the glut remained. And while there has been some relief of the excess inventory in the last 3 months, it certainly wasn't enough to prop up prices to encourage future investment. What this deal does is accelerate the drawdown of those excess of supplies to get to inventories in the world where they're comfortable, but not excessive. And if this agreement hadn't been done, I think prices would have probably floundered for another year in the 40s. So you know, and that would have created even longer term problems for the world in terms of future investment. And in terms of what impact does this have, I think, you know, why is it so important? It all has to do with two issues. One is investment, which the Secretary General has talked about, and one is the financial deficits, both of producers, but also of the member countries as well that are in OPEC. In terms of the investment side, it was talked in the 2040 presentation just recently, there's been devastating decrease in investment. And OPEC's talked about this, the IEA has talked about it. Global oil and gas investment in the world has gone from approximately $700 billion 2 years ago to $550 billion last year to about $380 billion this year. That is unsustainably low. The IEA actually says you need, and we in industry agree, about $600 billion a year of investment to hold global oil and gas production flat. And we're way under that. And it's likely that the investment for this coming year in 2017 is going to be approximate to that $380 billion we talked about. So the world is at an unsustainable position in terms of investment for future oil and gas production. The second key point is the industry is hemorrhaging financial deficits. If you just look at the public companies that are in the exploration production business in the world, after reduced capital expenditures that we just talked about with lower investment levels and dividends, the industry is running about $100 billion a year financial deficit. That was last year, that's this year. And OPEC itself is running approximately a $500 billion deficit after their government expenditures. This is not sustainable. So basically, something had to give. So I think with this agreement, we're certainly entering a new chapter for oil prices, one of upward trajectory. and very encouraged that that will incentivize investment today to make the important growth in oil supply that we're going to need in future years. Another interesting point is not just why oil prices are important to the world economy and price stability and energy security in the world economy, but it's also important for the stock markets. Conventional wisdom a couple years ago was that if you had a low oil price, it would be good for the stock market. But actually, in the last 12 months, there's a very high correlation between oil prices and the stock market. And so as a consequence, the takeaway from this is stronger oil prices are actually good for a strong stock market.
So it's a great point about how it's very good for the sort of investment and certainty and what's been happening with the oil markets. One of the things I wanted to ask you about, Secretary Barkindo, was you mentioned yesterday, clearly deal is done, you met with some analysts. Oil market analysts are analyzing what's going to happen with the market in terms of the response to the deal. One of the fundamental questions that's still out there is, in a low price environment that may stay between sort of a $50 to $60 to $70 range over the next several years, a lot of OPEC members, as John just mentioned, are feeling the pain as much as industry is and having to make some hard adjustments. What is your perspective on how difficult sustaining those cuts will be beyond a 6-month time frame? And in light of the kind of difficulty that I'm sure you discussed at the IMF when you were there yesterday, that some of your member companies are experiencing, how hard is it going to be to sustain those kinds of cuts and that sort of discipline if the market environment and price environment remains low?
Thank you very much, Sarah. I think what our member countries and other producers from the non-OPEC went through in the last 2 years has been probably the most severe, as you have heard from the corporate world represented by John here. Almost all our member countries have reporting high deficit numbers, contraction in their economies, including the most well-off among them, have already embarked on some austerity measures, have launched themselves into the debt market in order to plug these holes. So in terms of the pain, I think what we have gone through, what we have witnessed in the last 2 years cannot by any means be compared with what is required for us to restore this market stability by the actions that we took in Algiers as well as in Vienna, both on the 30th of November and 10th of December with the 11 countries from non-OPEC. Yes, some of our customers, particularly from Asia, continue to ask for more crude because of the robust demand there. But we have our eyes on stock levels, on inventories, which was the main variable in the equation that led to this disequilibrium in prices. Although we have seen this stock draws continuing, in the last 3 months we have seen continuous stock drawdown, but we are still over 300 million barrels over the 5-year industry average. So to restore this balance, we have to continue to stimulate and accelerate the stock drawdown to bring the levels to the 5-year average. And I think here there's a convergence of views between us as well as the IEA, and also Adam Smitsky agrees with this, that with this concerted efforts by both OPEC and non-OPEC, we would be able to bring forward this rebalancing, depending also on the level of compliance, which we are going to work very hard through this joint committee to ensure that we have a very high level of compliance both within OPEC and non-OPEC.
So stock levels certainly being one of the key variables in the market rebalancing. Another one that folks are very interested in is the responsiveness of tight oil, especially here in the United States. John, do you have a view on what we've learned over the last several years and what you project about the responsiveness of tight oil going forward?
Yes, well, I think the key question is, can shale and OPEC coexist? And the answer is absolutely yes. Shale, you have to remember, is about 4.5 million barrels a day of oil production out of 97 million barrels a day in the world. It is not a swing producer. The only swing producer that we know of is really Saudi Arabia, that can go up several hundred thousand barrels a day or down several hundred thousand barrels a day in short order. But shale is a short cycle producer, and this is a new key variable in the supply mix going forward. And what does short cycle mean? It's between 6 and 12 months from the final investment decision to first oil, where long cycle, like the offshore deep water, is somewhere between 3 and 5 years from the final investment decision and first oil. So it's a new variable that we have to contend with. But when you think about that, it obviously was, because it's short cycle, the one that felt the biggest brunt when prices went down. So as a consequence, when the prices started to fall into the 40s or even lower into the 20s, what you saw was a devastating decrease in the rig count in our country from 1,900 rigs to about 600 rigs today. And also, as a consequence from peak, U.S. oil production has gone down 1 million barrels a day. So the U.S. has already made its cut. And I think it's very much a function of the fact that those low prices weighed on short cycle shale more than they did on any other supply source. Now, in response to those low prices and the impact that it's had on the industry, there have been a couple of responses. And I think it really shows American ingenuity and innovation at its best. What's happened is that we as an industry have really innovated to get our costs down. So it's in operating efficiencies, where, as an example, our company in the Bakken, where we are a leading producer of about 100,000 barrels a day of oil production, we've been able to take our drilling times in the last 2 to 3 years from 30 days to spud and spud a new well to 15 days. And the industry has followed a similar path. In addition to that, we've made changes in our completion techniques in terms of number of stages, how much proppant is used, to get more production or recovery out of the wells themselves. So as a consequence, where the IEA a year ago, rightfully so, said at $60, shale production in the United States would stay flat, that number really now is $50. So while the industry has lost 1 million barrels a day from peak, mainly due to shale decreases, over the last couple of years, where we are now is at $50. Shale production is pretty much going to stay flat. And you're starting to see that in the month-to-month numbers that Adam brings out every month. Having said that, while it's flat at that level at $60, with the increase in rig count that is underway right now, we actually see shale production 6 to 12 months from now starting to go up in the range of 300,000 barrels a day. But you know, when I talked about shale and OPEC coexisting, that increase in production is not going to be enough to meet the worldwide demand growth of 1 million barrels a day or the production declines of 2 to 3 million barrels a day that occur from the base. So shale is going to be needed for sure, but so is long cycle. And that long cycle is from OPEC. That long cycle is from offshore deep water. Mm-hmm. And it's important to look at the long cycle for a second, because that part of the industry has been devastated as well. Nearly 60 projects have been deferred, about $40 billion of investments been deferred. Over the longer term, the OPEC outlook shows trillions of dollars are going to be needed in the investment in OPEC, in shale, and in offshore deep water, and in heavy oil. And right now, worldwide exploration has been decreased in response to the low price from $100 billion a year to $40 billion a year. About half of that is for the deep water. And the pipeline of new projects has basically run dry. Mm-hmm. So we need higher prices, not just for shale, but also for long cycle. So you have short cycle and long cycle. And our company has taken the strategy to be half unconventional, half conventional, half onshore and half offshore deep water, because as you look forward, shale is not going to be enough to meet the world's future demand for oil. You're going to need OPEC, you're going to need the offshore, and that's why we have about half of our business in the Bakken, which is short cycle, and another half in the offshore deep water, where we recently had a discovery that we have 30% of offshore Guyana. That's the largest oil discovery in the last 10 years. It's a big resource, it's low cost, it's going to offer great returns. It should come on in the first phase in 2020. But that oil is going to be needed, and we're going to invest in the cycle to make sure that we have long cycle oil going along with short cycle oil. And it's very important that you think about this. Everybody tends to talk about shale, and shale is becoming the new OPEC. Not the case. Shale's short cycle, OPEC and deep water are long cycle. You're going to need both for sustainable prices going forward.
Yeah, thank you very much. I can't agree more with John. Our world oil outlook shows clearly the continued growth in demand for oil up to the year 2040. The estimates we have projects about additional growth demand of about 17 million barrels a day. Now, whether we are in conventional or unconventional parts of this industry, the global oil industry is one industry. For us, I must share with you that we observed with great admiration the ingenuity, the technological innovations, the managerial competence, particularly in cost cutting, still maintaining high productivity that has been recorded, particularly in tight oil in the United States. This is very important, not only for the United States, but for the global oil industry. This is what we encourage the long cycle players that you referred to also emulate, because it's good for the health of the global oil industry. We never saw tight oil as a competitor. We saw tight oil as a necessary innovation in order to plug some parts of this robust growth. Just think of it for a moment. If we had no tight oil, what would have happened? The conventional oil would not have met this rising demand that we saw. It's impossible. And because our projects by nature are of long gestation period, as you have said, I think the industry is very proud of the achievements of tight oil, particularly in the United States. And when the pains came, we were all hurt. And now, we are advocating this dialogue to meet as an industry in order to compare notes, to share our perspectives, our experiences, and get guidance from each other on how not only of maintaining this or restoring and maintaining this stability that we badly need, but also to avoid these type of cycles in future. We all know that our industry is cyclical, but this last cycle or this current cycle that we are just emerging out from, it's a consensus that it's probably the worst that we have seen. And we in OPEC, we are confident that through this dialogue that we have embarked upon, we should be able to put our thinking caps right and come up with measures, joint measures, both from the corporate world, from sovereign governments, as well as the industry as a whole. If we cannot avoid these cycles, but at least we should minimize the devastating effects that we have seen. So I want to use this opportunity to urge you to see us as partners who belong to the same industry. And I want to tell you that whatever we do that is good for OPEC is good for the industry as a whole. And what is good for this industry is good for the United States. Yes. And whatever is good for the United States is good for the global economy. So we are all in one boat at the end of the day. So imagine out of this cycle, we would like to leverage on our relationships with CSIS, for example, and other institutions in order to promote this dialogue across nations, producers, whether between OPEC and non-OPEC, between ourselves and the corporate world, both in tight oil as well as conventional oil, because for us, this is the only way going forward to meet the expectations of these growing numbers that we have seen Jorge shared with us of billions coming into this planet and by right should have access to energy in order to pursue their growth and developmental aspirations and objectives.
Well, I know I speak on behalf of everybody, John Hamry and everyone at CSIS, that that we certainly work very hard and support your effort to global energy market stability. It's a difficult thing to do with all the transitions that we're experiencing, both in economies that are growing and ones that are slowing down, but also the new resources that we're discovering. So I think it's a laudable effort and one we're happy to be part of. I want to open it up because I know people will have questions, but I do want to ask one more of the two of you before we do that. And John will be familiar because he was here for this discussion we had with Fatih Birol, the head of the IEA for the World Energy Outlook, and it was brought up in your discussion. But it's really the question of peak demand, right? So this peak demand question has been fairly pervasive both in industry boardrooms and certainly within government policymaking shops. We saw your outlook and sort of some of the view that you have on peak oil and when Fatih was or peak oil demand and when Fatih was here, he had sort of made a point of saying, you know, they didn't see peak oil demand until, you know, 2040 timeframe, which is a little bit different than what we had been hearing from some other players not too long before. I want to get both of your views on how you think about not only peak oil demand as a question of when will it be reached, just sort of that frame, but how is it factoring into the decision-making within OPEC member countries and OPEC as a whole? Does it factor into your discussions? Is it increasingly important? And I say it because when we had Minister Naimi here, it was something that he brought up as well. So clearly it was on his mind. So I was wondering how it has factored into your discussions, and then John, just to get your views as well.
Thank you very much. Yes, the issue of peak theory has been one of those theories that have become a recurring decimal over the years. And this theory has been defied several times. Of course, models being used both within the IEA, the EIA, OPEC, and other agencies continue to be more and more sophisticated. And we are seeing certain convergence of the outcome of these models. But for us within OPEC, we take it in its stride. All our member countries have signed onto the Paris Climate Agreement. About five or six so far, I believe, have ratified. Why? We are all developing countries. We are severely impacted by climate change, the effects of climate change. And despite the fact that the Millennium Development Goals have made sustainable development, particularly combating energy poverty in developing countries, one of its key priorities, but we are not losing sight of the consequences of climate change on exacerbating poverty among our populations. So you can see that the two scenarios that Jorge talked about are both contingent upon how we move from the Paris Climate Agreement going forward. I was recently in Marrakesh at the COP22, which in my view turned out to be a non-event COP because the most important party delegation to COP in Marrakesh was in transition. Therefore, the international community that gathered in Marrakesh were waiting to hear from this most important member of the UNFCCC. Without its leadership in implementing the Paris Agreement, the whole agreement may risk being in possible jeopardy, in my opinion. We have seen a similar situation when the US Senate withheld its ratification of Kyoto Protocol, voted 95-0 against Kyoto. We saw the consequences on the Kyoto Protocol. Without the US leadership, it would be almost impossible to realize the target of Paris. Now, this is not to say that we fully agree with the outcome and the programs. We joined the consensus in Paris in order to move this process forward. But we have also noted with concern some of the fundamental principles of this process that have been compromised in order to build this fragile consensus that now is being put at risk by the huge uncertainty. So while we are focusing on this, for us, the overriding priority for us is to continue to meet this growing demand. Whether there is peak demand in 2030 or in 2040 or in 2050, so long as there will be continued demand growth, OPEC must continue to invest together with the industry to meet this demand, to guarantee security of supply, not only currently, but for future generations.
We certainly don't see oil demand peaking, at least for the next 25 years. Nobody has that crystal ball that can go out that far, but we would certainly subscribe to the studies and outlooks that OPEC has, as well as the IEA, the EIA, other companies as well. While it won't peak oil demand growth because of efficiency and conservation, its rate of growth actually slows over the time period. So there is an impact from efficiency, but it's not enough to offset the other demographic impacts that were talked about earlier. The world's growing from 7 billion people, God willing, to 9 billion people over the time period to 2040. Energy demand's going to grow about 1% a year. And while renewables will certainly speak for the biggest increase in growth on a relative basis from about 12% of energy demand to about 18% of energy demand in that period, oil and gas will still be about 50% of that energy demand in 2040. So at the end of the day, we need to make the investments today to ensure 10 and 20 years from now, we have the oil there to meet the growing demand that is out there. I think one example may bring this into focus, and that is a kilogram of energy from a battery versus a kilogram of energy from gasoline. The gasoline has 60 times more power, 60 times more energy density than that battery. So while batteries are important, you know, the technology and capability that they offer today are not enough to offset that increased power that gasoline has in the internal combustion engine. So we need to redouble our efforts on research. It's very heartening that Bill Gates and a group of other philanthropists have set up this $1 billion fund. You know, you have to take that seriously. It's all with the best of intents, which is to make our economies more efficient and to help in the decarbonization effort. But at the end of the day, we have to have clear eyes about what technology can and can't do today and make our decisions with that reality.
Okay, a little bit of a longer transition view then. Okay, we're gonna take questions. We've got some ground rules. Please wait for the microphone, state your name and affiliation, and if you could put the question in a form of a question, we'll be really happy about that. We're gonna start right here, Shayla.
Hi, my. Thank you for doing this. My name is Andriy Sitov. I'm a Russian reporter in Washington, D.C. I'm with TASS. Thank you, sir, for a great presentation. In light of what you just said about us all being in the same boat and the U.S. leadership, which non-OPEC countries do you see maybe joining the agreement to limit production? Are you looking for a sort of an understanding with the U.S., especially now that we have a new Secretary of State designate, Mr. Tillerson, that comes from the industry? Does this give you hope? And a technical issue, what level of prices do you see for oil for next year? Thank you.
Yes, as I have said earlier, we had 11 non-OPEC countries who met with us in Vienna on Saturday, the 10th of December, led by the Russian Federation. In the declaration that we have signed, the declaration of cooperation between us and these countries, we have stated it very clear that we are not closing on other non-OPEC producers who may wish to join this partnership in the interest of all producers as well as consumers. You have heard from my partner, John, the impact of this cycle on the U.S. industry, particularly on tight oil. The U.S. Had lost nearly 1 million barrels of production. Now, for us, going forward, we have to close ranks, not only among ourselves as OPEC, but with our friends, these 11 countries to start with, and then also launch into dialogue and consultations with the industry, because they are the operators. They are there on the battlefront, if you like. So it has to be a comprehensive set of consultations and dialogue, which I'm glad the CSIS is leading us in facilitating this dialogue by organizing this type of forum.
Great. Okay. We'll take one right across here.
Good morning. Steve Herman from The Voice of America. Following up on an unanswered question that the Russian reporter just asked, it looks like from now on, it was announced this morning by President-elect Trump that there will be two friends, big friends of oil in the cabinet, Secretary of State Tillerson, if his nomination is confirmed, and Rick Perry, the governor of Texas, who's obviously well acquainted with the oil industry. So what is your reaction, and how do you think the OPEC nations will react to these two appointments?
There's no doubt that the choice of Rex Tillerson it's a very important one. It's not only important for the U.S., but I think it's important for the global community because of what he's bringing on board as an accomplished oil technocrat who rose to become a CEO. A very successful CEO, for that matter, of probably the world's largest listed oil and gas company. He is an understatement to say that Rex is more than qualified to occupy this very important office, particularly at this challenging time. There is a very thin line between oil, geopolitics, and diplomacy. this I've learned from my professor John Payden, and I believe in this doctrine. Rex Tillerson, I know personally. He's a very accomplished gentleman, very measured, very broad, and bringing a very wealth of experience in the corporate world. And through that experience has built a very credible network across nations, across continents. He would be a great asset to the incoming administration, to the United States government, and we in OPEC, as well as our member countries. I want to use this forum, if you permit me, to congratulate Rex for this very well-deserved appointment. And we look forward to continue to interact with him at different levels, not only as an oil technocrat coming from our constituency, but now he has become a product for the whole world. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I might bring another perspective. While I do not know Governor Perry personally, I know Rex Tillerson very well. He is an outstanding business executive. He does his homework. He's always prepared. And he obviously has a very deep knowledge of global affairs. I think another perspective I might bring is just a more general one about the Trump administration. They've made it very clear that energy is critical. It's fundamental to the future of economic prosperity in the United States, and it's fundamental to growth. And oil and gas are really the future engine of the economy. And you've got to remember that this shale boom that has occurred has been so important in terms of our economy, in terms of jobs, where they're high-paying jobs, in terms of investment, where the industry is one of the biggest investors here in the U.S., and in terms of national security. So for those three reasons, you know, the Trump administration's policy that they've already articulated, details to follow, is fundamental to being pro-energy as an engine of the economy going forward.
And just in the interest of disclosure, Rex Tillerson is a member of the board of CSIS and has served with John Hess, so want to make sure that's quite clear. But I hope while we're sitting here, they don't pick off any more of our board members. So why don't we go back there?
Hi, it's Emily Meredith from Energy Intelligence. And Mr. Barkindo, I was just hoping you could help us understand your perspective on how quickly the cuts to OPEC and non-OPEC will rebalance the market. And we know this is for an initial period of 6 months based on how things are going at the moment. Do you anticipate that'll be sufficient or not?
Thank you very much. Very important question. The consultations that led to the Vienna agreement, we compared notes and projections made by both OPEC, the IEA, and the EIA, the three leading agencies making regular analysis and projections. And we have seen that without the action that we took, the rebalances, of course, in the fullness of time will take place. But when will that happen? Some of the projections were showing Q4 of next year slipping into Q1, Q2 of 2018. But the action we took on November 30th, endorsing the implementation of the supply adjustment of 1.2 million barrels a day that we agreed upon in Algiers on September 28th, and together with the contributions that we got from the 11 non-OPEC countries on Saturday, December 10th, of 558,000 barrels a day, a very impressive number from those countries, together taking effect from January 1, we project to see an accelerated stock draws. We have started seeing numbers already coming out both from Adam Smitsky and his friend Fatih Birol, very bullish numbers in terms of stock withdrawals that together, hopefully by second to the third quarter, we will be able to restore this balance. And that is why we are giving a lot of importance to the Joint Ministerial Monitoring Committee of five countries, three from OPEC, two from non-OPEC, working with us in the Secretariat to ensure very high level of compliance.
Okay, Jan?
I'm Jan Maris with Resources for the Future. Over the last 45 years, petroleum as a commodity has had dramatic increases and decreases in its prices, just like agricultural commodities and metals. To what extent do you think you have permanently changed petroleum from being a traditional commodity?
The oil business has always been a cyclical business. We obviously have had a lot of price volatility to the point that you're making. And I actually think we are entering a new chapter now of hopefully better price stability, where you'll have affordable oil, affordable energy going forward by us better understanding how short cycle shale works and long cycle OPEC and deep water work. And the more we can build that understanding and also work with consumers, I think we can you know, really enter a new chapter of more affordable, more stable, and more secure energy going forward. It's still going to be cyclical, and there'll still be peaks and valleys, but hopefully by us better understanding each other, and that's why the Secretary General's visit here and is sharing the OPEC outlook, I think is really a new era for us in terms of the United States, so we can better understand each other to help make sure that the consumers have the world have the oil, the gas, the affordable energy they need and deserve.
Okay. Got one way in the back.
My name is Ghislan Mohammed. I am business anchor in Al Hurra. Your Excellency, do you think that the prices will increase next year and we will see again $70 or $80 per barrel? This is the first question. The second question, what will be the mechanism from your side to make all the countries respect the agreement, the deal to cut the production? Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. As a matter of policy, we in OPEC had abandoned price targets. Way back when we used to have quotas. We have evolved with the market and the industry. And if you followed the presentation we had earlier, the entire process of these consultations leading to these historic meetings were focused mainly on this high level of stocks that have built up as a result of this stubborn glut, as John said, over the years. And it's agreed in this industry that the equation to maintain stability was disrupted by this one key variable of stocks. And to restore that equation to balance, we needed to address that. And hence the collaborative action that we are embarking upon come January 1 with the non-OPEC. What I can tell you is that the current price levels are a little bit far from the equilibrium price, but the equilibrium price will be dictated by the market at the end of the day. What we are doing is to assist the market to bring forward this rebalancing. Markets will always work, but sometimes, especially in this situation we have found ourselves, some level of intervention was urgently required, and it had taken I must confess, too long for us to build this consensus. And as John rightly said, it's not an easy task considering the different countries with different perspectives, experiences, and different interests. But what we have been able to achieve now is to lay down a solid foundation for a new global platform of OPEC as well as non-OPEC countries that will build a framework of structured and sustained dialogue and collaboration to minimize these effects of cycles of this industry, particularly volatility and levels of uncertainty, ensuring some level of stability in the interest of the continued growth and development of the industry. And that's why I refer to it as turning a new historic page, if you like. These are historic moments in our industry. John, I believe you share that. And therefore, going forward, we are determined to not only solidify this platform of OPEC, non-OPEC, but also to engage consuming countries, to engage operators, both in the conventional as well as the non-conventional. We are all one industry, and the consuming nations. The fastest growing demand country in 2016 turned out to be India, surpassing China this year in terms of demand growth. I was in New Delhi last week, and I heard from the Prime Minister words of congratulations for what we did in OPEC. Mm-hmm. Why? Because they share the same vision of stability. What they are interested in is stability of the market, stability of prices, so that they can plan. As a consuming country with 1.3 billion people and one of the fastest population growth you have seen from the slides of Jorge, most of this growth in demographics will come from the developing world, particularly these two countries. So I think on the whole, we are really in some historic moments and working together in the industry with governments, particularly some of the key players that are coming on board the new administration in the United States. It gives us hope and confidence that we're on course.
Okay. All right, we've got time for two more. I promise I'm making my way back up front. Megan?
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you. Hi, I'm Megan O'Sullivan from Harvard University, and thank you very much for this great conversation and opportunity. I'm really struck by your hopes for a global platform, but I actually want to ask you about something related to the outlook. I noticed in both the OPEC alternative scenarios, the first one has an aggressive policy implementation for climate goals, and the second one is a timely implementation of Paris. So can we assume that your reference case assumes something less than Paris? So the reference case assumes that Paris is not fully implemented, and does that mean that if Paris is fully implemented, as the scenario B suggests, that global demand for energy actually goes down and is a departure from your reference case scenario? I know that sounds technical, but the bottom line is your demand scenario dependent on Paris failing? Thank you.
The Paris Climate Agreement is key in the medium to long-term demand projections for energy generally. Hence, the two scenarios you have seen hinging their projections on the implementation of the Paris Agreement. One, on an aggressive and comprehensive implementation of the targets of this agreement as elaborated in the INDCs, gradually graduating into NDCs. And the other scenario is less aggressive, if you like, maybe with longer time frames. But be that as it may, both scenarios, as we have seen, will impact on demand projections. But what is coming to play now after Marrakesh, after what I saw in Marrakesh, I had good discussions with the U.S. delegation in Marrakesh, with the EU delegation in Marrakesh. The world is waiting anxiously to hear from Washington on the fate of the Paris Agreement. Yes, it's a multilateral process. It was a global consensus. And this global consensus was led and facilitated by the United States. I was in Copenhagen. I co-chaired the summit in Copenhagen. And I saw firsthand the consequences of our failure to get this consensus in Copenhagen. Mm-hmm. And President Obama did not give up. He worked very hard to ensure that Paris did not turn out to be another Copenhagen. Now, equally more important now is how do you operationalize the targets of Paris? How do you graduate the INDCs to NDCs? Within what time frames? And don't forget, as I've said earlier, in facilitating and cobbling this consensus in Paris, I think with the sensitivities of the experience of Copenhagen, some principles of the convention were compromised. The key principles of equity in the convention, the key principle of common but differentiated responsibilities and respective capabilities of parties, the overriding principle of combating energy poverty. These were all watered down. The classification in the convention between the Annex I and non-Annex I parties, the developed country parties and developing country parties, with the various levels of commitments and obligations, were all compromised in Paris in order to ensure that they were able to cobble this consensus going forward. So in our opinion, yes, we signed up to, and as I've told you, all our member countries have signed. Many have ratified, and the rest are in the process of ratification. We believe in this multilateral process. We believe this is the only way forward. And we insist on having our seat in the negotiating tables for the views of the energy sector, the oil and gas sector, the fossil fuel industry, and poor developing countries must be heard and must be taken into account in the operationalizing of Paris. But all this depends on what we get next year from Washington.
When we had Jonathan Pershing, the current special envoy for climate change here last week to give us a readout from Marrakesh and to talk a little bit about what expectations are for the United States leadership in that forum. Mm-hmm. It has been very interesting to see how many folks, both from the oil and gas community and the diplomatic community, are encouraging the U.S. to maintain an active role in those discussions, even if it is to be differentiated under a new U.S. administration, but that sustaining an active participatory role in that discussion is truly, really important. Okay, sir, you've been very patient. I think you'll be the last person we've got time for today. Thank you for being so generous with your time.
Hi, Peter Sommer with Capital Intelligence Group. My question is first for Secretary General, then Mr. Hess. You mentioned quite often you're trying to take counter-cyclical measures to address the volatility. Will you be pushing for OPEC members to be able to take hedging to hedge their oil production risks? IMF and World Bank have been playing around with it. I think Libya started looking at it, Mexico does. And Mr. Hess, I mean, I noticed that the Secretary General's met New York hedges, but nothing was mentioned on Chicago. Will you be helping oil producers, OPEC members, go on exchange trading in Chicago rather than over the counter, which is quite expensive to the taxpayers of oil producing countries? Thank you.
thank you very much. The decision for member countries or national oil companies of our member countries to embark on hedging programs are sovereign decisions of member countries. But I think it's instructive that from Washington, I'm heading to New York. I'm going straight to Wall Street, and I'm sure I'll be meeting with you and your colleagues in Wall Street. I was sharing with Daniel Yergin yesterday that way back in 1986, I spent some apprenticeship in both Chicago and in NYMEX as a young trainee. And I look forward to returning to Wall Street. The numbers are staggering. The evolution of that sector of the market and the industry has been very impressive. The impact of your activities on physical market has also been confounding. As I said earlier, just in the car, I was asking my colleagues here, please can you remind me what the volume traded today? In anticipation of meeting you here, probably. In NYMEX, this November, 27 million contracts, correct? 27 million contracts. In London, ICE, Brent, about 20 million. All together, nearly 48 million contracts in November. Vis-a-vis physical oil, John, 94, 95?
Yes.
Million?
Yes.
Yeah. So we have a vested interest in knowing your business, in working with you, in getting you on board this global platform that we are now building between OPEC, non-OPEC, and between producers and consumers, between us producers and operators, companies. I think that platform will be incomplete without you on board. Yeah. Will you agree to that?
And I think another perspective to complement what the Secretary General is saying, you know, for Hess, our strategy and business focus is to find, develop, and produce oil and gas to help meet the world's future demand for energy. It is not to hedge or trade with other companies to help them hedge themselves. We have our hands full just hedging our own production. Which as our activity level goes up to ensure that we have the cash flow on a year-to-year basis is something we'll give serious consideration to. But I just want to use this opportunity again to thank the Secretary General for being here in the United States. This is historic. The OPEC agreement was historic, but his presence here is historic. And it helps us in the United States better understand OPEC, but it also helps OPEC better understand the United States. It also helps OPEC producers better understand shale producers and shale producers better understand OPEC producers. And I think it sets a new foundation or a new chapter for greater price stability, affordability of oil, and also security of supply as we look out the next 10 and 20 years. And if I can, Sarah, why don't we give the Secretary General a warm round of applause.